16 times
in the letter of Philippians,
Paul uses the word joy. Either to rejoice, to be joyful, or to have joy. 50 times,
10, 20, 30,
40, 50 times in this letter, Paul refers to Christ. The thing that we want to understand is that Paul wanted our joy to be in Christ. The Apostle Paul loved the Philippians very much. We're going to learn a little bit about the story of how Paul came to know the Philippians and how the Philippians came to faith in Christ. If you look at the first two verses, though, who was Paul?
Paul.
But before he became Paul, his name was Saul. He was a man from the city called Tarsus. The Bible says that Saul was one of the most religious Jewish men. He had a passion for the things of God. And he followed all of the rules of what it meant to be a Jewish person. But when Christ came,
the
Son of God, the
Messiah,
then he died on the cross. And on the third day he rose again. And then the church began. And the gospel of Jesus Christ was reaching more people. And more people began to follow Christ. But Saul, who would later become Paul, he hated Jesus. And he hated the people who followed Jesus. The Bible says that he would go to the homes of where he thought Christians lived. And Saul and the people that were with him, They would kick the door in, and they would come in and they would drag out Christians. And they would beat them and throw them into prison. Acts chapter 7. It tells a story about Saul. How He oversaw the killing of a man named Stephen. Stephen was the first Christian to die for his faith. And after he told all the people that Christ was the Son of God, and Stephen spoke to all the people about Jesus, the Bible says that they gathered around him and they hurled stones at him. And the person who oversaw that was Saul. Two chapters later in the book of Acts, chapter
9,
Saul's passion in life was to oppose Christians and to kill Christians. And the Bible says he was on the road to a city called Damascus. And an overwhelming light comes from heaven. And Saul is blinded. And Jesus says, "Saul, why are you persecuting me?" He tells Saul to go into the city to a man named Ananias.
Ananias.
And then God tells Ananias that Saul's coming. At this point in time, all the Christians are scared of Saul. But God says, "I've chosen Saul." And at that point, God brings Saul. He uses Ananias to open up his eyes again. And God sends Paul to share the gospel with all the peoples. Paul was a horrible person before. And God ends up using him for great things. When we remember the Apostle Paul, he represents the grace of God. There's no person in this room that God can't use. If you're sitting here thinking, "I've done too many bad things," you think God can't use your life. When you remember Paul, that should drive away all those thoughts. All of our hearts at one point were bad. But God redeems us. And he calls us his own for his purposes. And so Paul introduces himself as a servant of God. The next slide. That word was the word doulos. It was Paul's joy to introduce himself as a slave of Christ. Romans chapter 6 reminds us that were either a slave of sin leading to death, or were a slave to obedience to Christ, leading to life. The Apostle Paul said, Christ Jesus came to save sinners. Of which I am the worst. I really believe that Paul never forgot who he was. And it always gave him so much joy who he was in Christ. If you go back to verse 1, he says, so Paul and Timothy. Timothy was his son in faith. Timothy was his closest companion. In their writing to the Philippian believers, he says to all of the holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, but if you skip forward to the map, where was Philippi? It was a city in northern Greece. One thing that is interesting is that we know Ephesu and Colossae. Tarsus is where Paul was from. Jerusalem is where Christ died and where he rose again. And as the message of the gospel began to spread, it spread through the area where Ephesus and Colossae were. And the Bible says that everywhere that Paul went, he shared the gospel. And so he wanted to take the gospel to the west. But the Bible says the Spirit of God would not allow him. And God told him to head around to the direction of Philippi. Philippi was a Roman colony. And so there was a main road that went through it, and so many people traveled through the city of Philippi. And so when Paul comes to Philippi, the Bible tells the story in Acts chapter 16. The whole chapter 16. But you can go to the next scripture in Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. And so I want you to think about this for a second. We're going to come back to these verses. But when Paul talks about the Philippians, he really, really loved these believers. His connection with them was deeper. The joy that he had in the friendships with the Philippians was deeper. And he says, I thank God every time I remember you, Philippians. All my prayers for you, I pray with joy. Why? Because of their partnership in the gospel from the beginning up until now. And so then he says in verse 6, I'm confident of this, that God who has begun a good work in you will finish that work until the day of Christ Jesus. So what was Paul's connection with the Philippians? Philippians. How did he love them so much? When I think about the story of the Philippians, sometimes I think about the story of how our church started. 5 years ago, there was no Karenni Christian Fellowship. But we have seen the power of God. We've seen the hand of God doing things so that we might come together and that we might partner in the gospel together. And be a part of what God is doing. But when Paul came to the city of Philippi, there was no Jewish church there because it was a Roman colony. But it was Jewish, so he comes there and it's the day that they should go to church. And it was Jewish custom to go down on the day of worship down by the nearest river. So there's four guys. Paul. Silas. Timothy. And Luke. Luke is the author of the Gospel of Luke. And he's the author of the book of Acts. So they get down to the river. And there's a group of women that are praying. These were a small group of women that feared God. One of them was a woman named Lydia. The Bible says she was a seller of purple. She sold purple clothing. Dome is wearing purple today. Dome, can you stand up? Purple was a big deal. And so many think that Lydia was very successful selling purple clothing. So Paul shares the gospel of Jesus Christ with these women. And the Bible says that God opens Lydia's heart. And God saved Lydia. And the Bible says that she and her whole household believed and were baptized. So Lydia's family is the first European Christian family. So then what happened? Paul and Silas, they're going to share the gospel in Philippi. The very next day. And there was a young girl who had a spirit in her. It was an evil spirit. But it allowed the girl to tell people their future. And so the family would make a lot of money because they would have the girl tell people their future. And so as Paul and Silas would go around, the little girl would follow them. And she would say, "These are servants of the Most High God." Well, she did this day after day. She would follow Paul and Silas. And eventually, Paul looks at her. And he talks to the demon in her, not to her. He says, "Get out of her." In the name of Jesus Christ, leave her. And that spirit came out of her. And she was freed from that. But her family made a lot of money on her. So they get angry at Paul and Silas. And they get all the people in the town of Philippi to go against Paul and Silas. The Bible says eventually that they stripped off Paul and Silas' clothes. And they beat him with rods. What a terrible turn of events. They celebrate eternal life with Lydia. They baptize her and celebrate her union with Christ. And then after casting out an evil spirit, they're beaten and they're thrown in prison. So here's Paul and Silas. Their bodies are beaten and sore. They're thrown into prison. And they're sitting there, and the Bible says that they were put into the inner cell of the jail. And the Bible says that they put locks on their feet. Couldn't move their feet, and they locked their hands. And the Bible says that about midnight, Paul and Silas were crying. And complaining. It doesn't say that at all. The Bible says that about midnight, Paul and Silas were singing and praising God. How great is our God? And all the other prisoners heard them singing. And the Bible says there was a great earthquake that shook the place. And all of their chains fell off. I want to say before we go on, if your situation is bad, it's probably not worse than Paul's. I've never been beaten because of my faith in Jesus. I've never been thrown into prison because of my faith in Jesus. Sometimes we face opposition. Sometimes people will say stuff about us because we're Christian. But we need to be prepared that no matter what comes my way, just like Paul and Silas, my situation does not define my joy in Christ. Paul had a joy in Christ that it didn't matter what happened to him. He wanted the Philippians to have that kind of joy. God wants for you to have that kind of joy in Christ. So the earthquake shakes. And And the jailer, the guy that works at the jail, thinks that they're gone. The Bible says that he drew his sword and he was going to take his own life. And Paul says, stop, we're still here. Paul and Silas could have ran as fast as they could. They could have ran out of there. But they stay and they share the gospel with the jailer. The Bible says the jailer fell at the feet of Paul and Silas and he said, what must I do to be saved? Paul said, repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And again, this jailer and his family were baptized and they believed. So here's the first two families in the church at Philippi. A woman named Lydia and the guy that worked in the jail. And the Bible says that the Philippian church continued to grow in the grace of God. Friends, in the same way that God began our church, I remember, I know Pore and Tuame are not here today. I remember meeting in their home. I remember all our Bible studies at Hickman. Paul loved these believers in Philippi. And they celebrated what God had done. And we know from the Bible, as Paul continued to go out in mission work and share the gospel, of all the churches that Paul had started, the Philippian church was the most generous financially to support Paul in the work of the gospel. And so I want to close. I think that we're going to get so much out of this series in Philippians. But as we begin this letter, Paul says to the believers, he says, I want you to know, Paul is writing to the Philippians from prison again. And he knows that the Philippians are probably worried about him. Because they've heard that he's in prison in Rome. Paul wrote Philippians from prison in Rome. And what does he want to write in the letter? Brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. Find your joy in Christ alone. There's a slide there that has a difference. There's a difference between happiness and joy. Our happiness depends on what happens. My joy is not that it is a crucial part. So our happiness can go up and down based on what happens. And I don't want you guys to have your joy depend on what happens. The Apostle Paul and God wants for us to have our joy in Christ. We're going to study some great passages of Scripture. In chapter 3, Paul says, the things that used to be gain for me, he says, all those things I count as loss compared to the all-surpassing value. Of knowing Jesus Christ and the power of His resurrection. Paul says in chapter 1, for me, the person who used to be so bad, but the person that God has called to share the gospel, he says, for me to live as Christ
and
to die as gain. I would encourage you to read Philippians this week. It's just 4 chapters. We're probably going to be maybe 8 weeks in Philippians. I encourage you to read the letter and be encouraged by what it has. If you're not able to read Karenni or English, I encourage you to get together with a brother or sister. And read it together. I pray in the next few weeks that more and more Jesus Christ is the source of your joy. A joy that your circumstances can't change. Amen.